For me, it's not so hard to introduce our preacher for today, but for those of you who don't know him, he is married with 4 children and a lovely wife seated under the 6. Is the right number. 4 is the right number, but 2 addition accumulated to 6 and 7. They don't reach that number yet. And she's sitting on the left at the first row. Amen. And he is vibrant. He is a wonderful speaker, one that I pay much attention while he preached, and help me to welcome none other than our host pastor, Brother Donovan. Before he comes, the choir will bless our hearts with their mission and listening.
Just wanna make it to heaven. foot say. Well done. Welcome. Which tells me that whatever we are doing, we better do it well. Whatever we are saying, we better say it well. Wherever we are going, we better make sure it is well with our Savior. I want to thank the choir for such a wonderful rendition. And I know heaven rejoices. I want to greet you all in the precious name of Jesus. It's happy to be back with you. You know, each time one would go, one would miss Jamaica Praise. Oh boy, Jamaica Praise is awesome. And so I miss, you know, the praise. But it is good to be here with you all in the precious name of Jesus. And so take greetings from the Benz family. The theme that I want to use today is pretty simple. And it is, and I want to say this to you before I continue here. That if you have your pen and your paper out, you better do some writing here. Because it's no wonder that the Lord would have placed in whomsoever heart to bring the psalm today. Because I sat there some days ago and the Spirit gave me this message that I need to bring back home to preach to us today. I did not have a title or a theme for it. So I called back home and I asked the question, what song will you be singing? I didn't get an answer right there, but when I got here, I questioned again, what song are you singing? And so they told me the song that they had prepared to sing. And right as the go-get, when they said what they said to me, I said, that's it. That's the team that I'm going to need to bring today. And it is a simple one. It is as followed: will he answer you? Well done. Well, you didn't get that. So I want to say it again. On that day, will he answer you? Well done.
Satisfying to God.
And so the word I want to use today is satisfactionally accomplished. It has to be satisfactionally accomplished. It cannot be any and any kind of service to God. It has to be one that satisfies God. And so let us understand here today, friends, it is not on our terms. It is on the terms of God that we must walk so as to hear those words, well done. Those two words are words that you must live, walk, and die to hear. Well done. My question today is, are we doing well? How well are we doing as we walk into the ministry of God? You see, once we walk into the ministry of God, we become a minister for God. Can I hear an amen for that? Can I say that again? Once we walk into the ministry of God, we know that we became right there a minister of God.
Amen.
And as we know is a minister of God. Let me get it right. As we know becomes the ministers of God, we need to understand what kind of race we are running. See what I do. A lot of we here, because I don't want to leave out myself. And so I want to pluralize most of that which I will be saying, because it is about the preacher man too. It is about the choir members. It is about everybody. Even if you're here today and you have not yet become a minister of God, I want you to understand it is for you too. He answer you, well done. I could have imagined all of us that are here would have done something great to our pastor or whosoever we are associated with, and we would have heard from them, well done, and a pat on the shoulder, and how good it feels. And so it is important, beloved, that as we work for God in the ministry of God, that we run our race well so that we can hear from Him, well done. It must be a word that is satisfactorily accomplished. Sometimes, because we know that God is so good, and that's why we sing so many times, God is so good. He's so good to me. And indeed, if you believe that God is good, clap your hand. God is so good. And because we believe and we know, we heard it, that God is so good, then we do so many things that are not pleasing to Him. In other words, we abuse God's goodness. Because He is merciful, long-suffering, forgiving, tender in mercy, and you name it. We abuse His kindness. There are so many people that others would have abused because of their kindness, because of their forgiving spirit, because of their mercies. Then people abuse their kindness. And so it is with God. Many of us abuse God's mercy, kindness, and grace. I'm saying to us today, friends, will He answer us? Well done. Will God answer you? Well done. And if He answers you, well done, will it feel satisfying? Will it leave a feeling that you could walk away and say, yes, God, I have done my best. Yes, God, I could never have done more. Yes, God, I have gone the last mile of the way. beloved, we need to serve God with that attitude where we must find everything our hands find to do to give to God, so at the end of the road we can hear from God, well done, and it can be a satisfying feeling. I'm saying to us, beloved, some of the times we can do more, but because of who we view God as, we stay away. But I'm saying to somebody today, it is time for the church to wake up. It is time for somebody here to wake up and understand that God is counting on you. Somebody lift your hand in the air and say, God is counting on me. Understand, friends, when we hear that word, well done, we need to feel good in ourselves that we have run our race well, that we have fought that good fight, that we have kept the faith, that we have finished our course, and henceforth now laid up for us crown of righteousness. Will that well done be satisfying to your heart? Will you walk away and say, God, I've done my best? Question I want to ask you today, are you doing your best to hear well done? It's okay, want to hear well done. But will it be okay when God said well done to you and I because you had run your race well? Think about that. Now this is the first, as I said it before, in a three-part message or series. And so, as we go into our tents, so as to identify some things that we should understand to hear well done from God, we have to be walking in these things. If we are not willing to walk in these things, I'm saying to somebody today, don't be willing to wait for that well done from God. And so let us go to our text, which is 2 Corinthians chapter 2, chapter 6 rather. And we are going to go down from verse 1 to 5. You know what I call this message today? A lecture type of message. So if you see me jumping, don't pay me any mind. If you don't see me jumping, still don't pay me any mind. But I want you to get the word today, because it is important. And it is for everybody that are here listening to the voice of this preacher man. Hey, we saw earlier on 6 men bringing you back. Lay down in the casket. Some of us have been running away from God for too long, for so long. But I want, as the psalmist said earlier on, you and I one day will be lying in our casket. Helpless. When 6 men would take us before the preacher man. And the preacher man would preach his little sermon. Because we could be bad and bold. We could be rich or poor. We could be black or white. We are going to die one day. I'm saying to somebody, before you die, make sure your word will speak for you that day when God will be saying to you, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You can stay all you want to stay and criticize anything and criticize anyone and say all manner of things, but one day you're going to answer. We're going to answer to God. So it's about you now. It's about me now. It's about me standing before God. And so Paul wrote to the Corinthian church these things. And to us today, I'm presenting it to us. And so let us go to 2 Corinthians 6, verse 1. Paul said in verse 1, we then as workers, we're talking about workers, we're talking about partners. We are partners together in the kingdom of God. I remember days gone when I used to do farming. I used to work with someone. And they would have had more than one person working with them. And I realized that, boy, I would be working. I used to weed grass, as they call it, in St. Elizabeth. And so I would be there weeding. Brother Campbell knows what I'm talking about. And I would be weeding and sweating, and the other guys were sitting there talking to each other, and I was working down the road. And so I look at him and say, listen to me, brother, you are getting more paid than I, and I'm working so hard. Come on, do better than that. And I said that to say to us, in the kingdom of God, in the vineyard of God, some of us are like that. We sit back while others work their shirt off. And because the boss loves you, you think the boss loves you more than me, then you will get away with so many things. And so you neglect the work. I'm saying to lock, stock, and barrel here today, with God, it doesn't work like that. So let us work together. Because we need to hear well done. So church, I'm calling on us today. Don't sit by idle. Don't watch Nick Tom and Harry going up. And because God is so good, you're locked behind. I'm saying, even if you hear well done that day, make sure it will be a satisfying one to you.
Amen.
And so Paul said, listen to me, Corinthian brethren. We as workers are partners together with him. You know the him we're talking about? The big man. I like to call him like that. The big man upstairs. Somebody said, I have a God with a music on the thing. Bring about the music. Somebody said, I have a God who really cares. And that's the God I'm talking about today. The big man upstairs. He said, we are workers together with him. Understand that. I want everybody to understand that. That is not just you and the person beside you, but everyone. We are workers in the kingdom of God. We are working to hear well done. Yes. Your work is not mine. My work is not yours. Your work is yours. My work is mine. Everybody's work will be their own work. So I'm saying to us, friends, let us stand up and fight. Let us work in the vineyard of God because we want to hear well done. Yes. We want to hear well done. So he said as he continues, I beseech you also that you, what? Are you following me?
Also.
I beseech you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. Can I tell somebody something? If you think we cannot receive the grace of God in vain, you made a sad mistake. If you think you can come, we can come and dress up in our ties and sing and shout and dance and neglect the affairs of God. I'm saying to you, that's in vain. Be careful, beloved, as we minister in God's vineyard, or else we will take his message in vain. We don't want to take his message in vain because we don't want to face that God with an in vain worship service. Can I say that again? We don't want to stand before God that day with a vague service, with a service that was just on the lips. We need not to stand before God on that day with a service that did not have any merit to it. We never want to stand before God that day with a service that did not have any depth. We never want to stand before God that day with a service that was unto yourself. But we want to stand before God with a service that was unto God. That is why we say unto thee, O God, do I lift up my soul. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed. Let not my enemies. Talking to me today. Let not my enemies be triumphant over me. I'm saying to you, friends, let us not take the message of God in vain. Let us not take the service of God in vain. Because we are all ministers in the ministry of God. Now we're going to talk about this day. We're going to talk about today. Because if you believe it's tomorrow, we need to work so as to hear well done. We are going the wrong path. It is today. It is not tomorrow. Many of us are putting off until tomorrow. Many of us are touching until tomorrow. Many of us are walking until tomorrow we make it right. What I'm saying to us, it's not about tomorrow. It is about today. It is about today, somebody.
Amen.
We're going to live today for to hear tomorrow. Well done. So I like what verse 2 said. Hear what verse 2 said. Oh my God. Before I go to verse 2, I want to tune in on that word in vain. That word vain. Vain speaks to something not healing the desired outcome. Something not healing the desired outcome. What God desires for you and I, if it is not the outcome that He requested or desired, I'm saying it is in vain. And if you want my hand, let them stay there until I come back. But when I'm gone, you took these flowers and you put it around about there, because no sun was around here. You put it there and you water it and everything. And when I come, I'm going to say to you, where are those flowers that I asked you to put on the out? You know what you're going to tell me? Oh, they are over there. Yes, you work, but your work would not be pleasing to me because I had asked you to take them and put them out there. And many of us are trying to switch on God. But can I tell you something, friends? If you switch on God, your work will be in vain. I'm saying to you, friends, let us not take the grace of God in vain. It's not about what you think. It's not about how you feel. It's not about how best it is going to be. It's about God's requirement. It's about God's desire for your life. It's about God's outcome for your life. I'm saying to you, make sure that we are living God's outcome. Or else all our service will be in vain. That's what Paul is saying here. Don't take it in vain. It continues. Hallelujah. It said, we're talking about the word vain. Not only the desired outcome, like having our work be done in vain, that meaning that it has no merit. I would not be interested in the work that you would have done. I remember one day I was a tailor, my profession still is, but I was working. Alright? And so somebody brought a piece of material to me. And I cut it out. But the hip was too big. And so I had to join beneath the inside of the pants, down here. I had to cut and join it so as to get the pants to fit the brother. Alright, so I worked hard at those 2 nights and I set up his pants and I put seam in it. The seam could cut you. and I thought, yes, I had it. I thought I was gonna get my pay and here, well done, brother. And so I felt good in myself. When the brother come and take up the pants and look at it, from cross it was good. But when he turned the pants upside down, he saw a piece of the shining underneath the pants. And he was upset with me. He was mad at me because I should never join his pants. And I didn't get paid for that pants. I had to go and buy my material and sew the pants, give him the way it should have been done. And yet still I worked hard on those 2 pants. But I did not get a well done because that work was in vain. It was not done to his suit. And I lost all those nights, all those hard work, all those thread and needle, all the light bill. I lost it all. I'm saying to somebody today, if we treat God like that, our work is going to be in vain. And there will not be a well done from God. I'm saying to us, friends, let us not take God's grace. Let us not take God's grace in vain. Not because God's grace is merited. We must treat it right. We must condition our life unto God. The outcome of our life must be towards God's desire. So that we can hear well done. Or else we are going to be in trouble. So I want to touch on that little word vain. Let's move on. Verse 2. We're talking about don't take it in vain. Let's talk about verse 2. God's, listen. God's grace, our kindness, is something, beloved, that we must pay attention to. But don't abuse it. Spirit. And so verse 2 said, for he said, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I what? Secured thee. Behold, now is. Behold, now is. You're not talking to me. Behold, now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. It is not tomorrow. It is not next year. It is not next week. It is today. And so I'm saying to you, number one, God, we call. We call. And God heard us. Let me go back to that verse to understand what the verse is saying here. He said, for he said, I have heard thee. If you never called, God wouldn't have anything to hear. So understand this now. We called, and God heard us. And not only that, he heard us. But number two, he accepted us. And not only that, he accepted us, but he helped us. I'm saying to you, friends, today, for those of you who haven't called us yet, today is that day that you need to call. Today is that day that God will answer you. I will hear you. Today is that day that God will accept you. Today is that day that God will help you. Not tomorrow. Not next year. Today. Today is the day of salvation. He said, harden not your heart. I chose to read those two verses for us to understand where we are going before we get to the things that we need to walk in. Now, as we work and becoming workers together, let us know in what work we must work. And so, beloved, there are 10 things I want to point out briefly today that we must walk in. As we become a minister, I'm going to point out something in verse 3. As we become a minister in the ministry of God, there are a few things that we must walk in if we are going to hear well done.
Yes.
And we better take them serious. There are 10 things we need to walk in. And so I have 10 ins to talk about today. Understand that. 10 ins. And we better follow carefully. Verse 3, I want to allude or bring your mind here. Verse 3 said, give in. I want to talk to the church people on that. Give in no offense to what? In anything. We have to draw back ourselves at this time and understand that we cannot give any offense in the ministry of God. And so all of us that get offensive and defensive because we believe we are standing upright and nobody can talk to me, I'm saying, friends, be careful how offensive we are and defensive we stand out, or else we will bring an offense in the ministry of God.
Come on.
And so he said, I want to read it again. He said, give no offense in anything that the ministry be not blamed. I want us to understand it, brother said, anything. Meaning anything. Because sometimes we face some challenge. The Bible said, if you eat meat and it offend that brother, you must stop it. And sometimes we believe that this what we are doing is okay and right, and nobody can talk to me because I am my own man and woman. I'm saying, be careful of offending anyone in anything. Did not say something in anything. If we are going to be able to hear well done, we have to walk this way in anything. Don't cause any offense in the ministry. And I like that he put ministry first, because to become a minister you have to walk into the ministry. And so follow me in that verse. He said, but in all things approving yourself as the minister us around that word God. Because we are not our own. When we walk out of the world and walk into God, we are now the ministers of God, administrating the ministry, administrating things in His ministry. So I'm saying to all of us, it doesn't matter how big we feel, how strong we are, I'm saying let us comply. Let us apply. Let us understand, friends, that God is counting on us and we are waiting to hear, well done. But if we are not going to apply, I'm saying we're not going to hear. Well done. We're not going to hear well done. So I want us now to approve ourselves as the minister of God. In the ministry to which He has called you and I. Approve yourself in these things as we go on. Hallelujah. So that the ministry, hallelujah, cannot be blamed. Oh Jesus, let's go on to verse 4. He said, in all things, approving yourself as the ministers of God. No, I'm going to bring this out to those 10 things that we better be careful of here. And the first one is what? Now read it, my man. The first one is not just patient. Thank you, my brother. Do you understand how significant that word much is to that verse? Because some of us is pacing up to a point. And when we get to that point, we lose it. But the Bible said, we must be patient. And we must be in much patience. That's the first thing we better look at. The first thing in the 10 things I want to point out today, we better be patient. We better be patient and much so. Have patience as we walk this pathway with Almighty God. Now, having patience speaks to having the capacity of a calm endurance. When we talk about patience, we need to be calm in our soul. Even when the weather around us of life is disturbing us, and the neighbors around us is fighting us, and the church people is against us, and the children, they're giving us trouble, and everything around us rising against us. I'm saying to us, we gotta walk in patience. We gotta go up in patience. We gotta exercise patience if we are gonna hear well done. The things of life is gonna ride our boat. And we better find the appetite of patience as we walk this pathway so as to hear well done. So as He told the Corinthian church in much patience, you better walk in there. He's telling us today, you gotta walk in much patience. So if you are here today and you believe, boy, you need to be more patient, you better apply it to your life. And if I'm here and I need to be more impatient, I better apply it to my life. You know why? Because I want to hear. Well done. The second thing that we need to walk in. Read it. We need to walk in afflictions. Friends, as we walk with God, we are walking in an affliction battle. And when we walk in an affliction battle, we got to understand we cannot give up. We cannot speak bad. We cannot speak ill. We have to face it. Can I talk to the Christians here today? We have to face the bullet. Afflictions are coming at us left, right, and center. But if we are going to be able to hear well done, we better bear it. We better bear on. And so the second thing that we need to do is walk in a fiction pathway. It's not easy. We are going to be afflicted. We are going to be bruised. We are going to be battered. But we must walk the walk. We must stop the talk. We must sing some redemption stories amidst our affliction valleys. Right, I said, wait in affliction valleys. Hallelujah. My Savior comes. I hope I'm saying the right time. My Savior comes and talk with me. I'm saying when you are in your affliction valleys, don't lose hope. Don't lose your purpose. Don't lose your intention. The word affliction speaks in this wise. A condition or cause of pain, suffering or distress. Tell me about pain. Tell me about suffering. Tell me about distress. The world is filled with suffering, pain, and distress. But church, we cannot give up. Church, we cannot let go. Because we want to hear well done. I'm saying, whatever distress, whatever whatever suffering, whatever pain, I'm saying walk in them. You will not get away from it. You got to walk in them. You got to be in your trial. You got to be in your cross. I heard the writer say, must Jesus be the cross alone, and all the world go free. No, there's a cross for everyone, and there is a cross for me. You got to walk up to your affliction. My brother, respect to the vows you made. But I want to promise both of you that you're going to walk through some destruction by you. You're going to go through some things in life, but you've got to remind yourself, I've got to be calm. This message helped me today. One of my sons said to me, how you are so calm today? Because some Sundays are miserable. Because I want to get them moving. But every time I want to stop out, I remember that one. Be calm. And I'm saying to your friends, you gotta go up with patient. You gotta go up with many afflictions. You gotta go up with many suffering. But I tell you today, they have to live out there. Talk to me, church. The heart of the battle, the sweet of the victory. So I'm saying to you, my brother and sister, go up in Jesus' name. So as to hear, we're done. I said to your friends, no matter what affliction valleys you have to walk through it in the name of Jesus. Because one day, somebody said one day, you're going to hear, we're done. So I'm encouraging somebody today. We're going to an affliction valley. To walk in it. Don't run away from it. Because you're going to hear well done. God, I want to continue. Number two. Read number two for me. Number three, rather. A patient. What was the other one? Affliction, and the second one is what? Necessities. Necessities. We got to go up in this fashion and understand that your walk is necessary. Can I say this to you today? Is it necessary for you to go back home? You better say yes. That's what we're talking about, necessities. It is necessary that you go back home. It is necessary that you get something to eat. It is necessary that you pay a tax. It is necessary that you do anything the government asks you to do. That's what we're talking about, necessities. It is necessary to come out and praise God. It is necessary to pray. It is necessary to worship. It is necessary to fast. It is necessary to... We got to go up in necessity. We don't feel like doing it, but we have to do it. Sometimes when the light will hit you, it comes more than you think. You should pay, but it's necessary that you pay it because they cut it off. I'm saying to your friends, as we march up this road, let us march with necessity. I don't feel good, but it's necessary that I do not. Forsake the assembly and myself together. It is necessary that I love my neighbor as I love myself. It is necessary that I love my enemy. It is necessary that I love those who persecute me and say, all manner of evil against me. Falsely, I heard the writer say, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward. Anything you do for Jesus, it's necessary. So when pastor tell you to do something, and you are frown, you have a face. Thank you, sister. You are not doing it for pastor. You're doing it unto God. That's what Paul said. Let's walk in necessity. Meaning of necessity is the quality or state of being necessary. anything that is necessary to your life, you better apply it. If you go to doctor for a complaint and doctor give you an injection, it's necessary.
Yeah.
If you go to doctor and he gave you prescriptions to take, it is necessary. Take it. And so I'm saying to your friends, it is necessary to walk the way God wants you to walk. Let's walk in it. It's necessary. No matter how simple it is, Brother Hugh, it's necessary. No matter how hard it takes us, it's necessary. God, I wish I had tough time here to go on. But we have some more that I want to point out. Let's go on. The fourth one is what? Distress. God, so much sometimes when we distress, is it? And we're not talking about money now. Some situation hit us and bring us under distress. We have bank book for the money, but some situation hit us and bring us down to this distress road. So it's not about money now. It's about distress. Generally speaking, I'm saying to the church today, when distress hit you, you better learn how to walk closer to Jesus. When distress comes into your left, right, and center, you better know that it's necessary to walk the King's high way. I heard a songwriter say, don't you know that I'm moving on the King's highway? Moving on the King's highway. Don't you know that I'm trusting in amazing grace? Trusting in amazing grace. Satan is on my track.
Yes, we are going to be deep down. We are going to be
some of us, I remember the story of the boxer. We were in a boxing match, and the guy knocked him down. While he was down, somebody come, 1, 2, 3, 10. Somebody come, 1. Keep counting. Keep counting. Stop. Now, when he reaches 9, the trainer said to him, hey, and 9 the man there, no? The brother said, I would have 10, me not get up. You understand? He's not going to get up because the blow was more than him. And so he said, would have 10, me not get up. I'm saying to us, friends, when it comes to our ministry with God, all when we knock down and the man reach up, 50, you better have a hope to get up. You better rise up. I don't know what I say. Sons of God, arise. Sons of God, arise.
Around us.
Sometimes our children put us there. Sometimes our leaders put us there. Sometimes even our own mistakes put us there and cause disturbance. Sleepless nights. We're walking like we lose our mind. We are in trouble left, right, and center. But I say in the name of Jesus, in spite of your trouble from every side, still walk in Jesus' name. Still talk in Jesus' name. Because you want to hear well done. My sister Lana, it is necessary. That we walk even though we are disturbed by the enemies. Not only that, it said, oh my, we talk about tremendous uprising, riot, mentally or emotionally, agitation. I'm saying wherever you go, you've seen riot left, right, and center. For those of you who watch news regular, you would understand what I'm talking about. Are the things that we are up against, and even so, it is at our door. We better walk the gospel way. We cannot give up, we cannot get frustrated. We have to walk in them labor. Are you there? Labor, beloved, is something that we have to walk in. Sometimes we're tired. I just got in from work and I have to come to church. Pastor God, you're not coming to Branding. You're not coming to Bible. You're not coming to choir practice. You're not doing this. You're not doing that. I'm saying it is necessary. It is necessary for us to walk in labor. The lazy business God is not in it. The tired business God is not in it. Christ got tired. Christ got weary. Christ got to that point where he said, take this from me, Jesus. We can't manage it. But he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. I'm saying to somebody here, when you reach that point, tell yourself, God is not my will, you know. But his thy will be done. And get going, somebody. I'm saying he might be frustrated, he might be disappointed, he might be let down. But get going. It's about labor. Let us labor till the master comes. Where labor speak to physical or material emotion or mental emotions. And sometimes some of the work that we have to do in Jesus, it takes away our emotions. It cripples us. But because it is necessary, we still do it. I came in Friday evening. And when I realized that the benches need wrapping and we need more material, I was dead tired. I was tired like crazy. I've been traveling from the night before, straight through, 12 hours, straight through, and three more, 15 hours, no rest, no sleep. And when I got in, I realized that the bench need material. So I said to the brethren, listen, I will go to Kingston tomorrow morning early and get this material. You know why? Because it was necessary. I'm saying sometimes we are like that, beloved. We must rise up and do because it's not our will. If it was my will, I would lie in my bed. But it's the will of God. I got me to Kingston. I got my tired, weary, want to sleep, but I still couldn't sleep. And we got the benches today. Clap your hand for Jesus. I'm saying, friends, you may be tired. You may be weary. But it is necessary to labor until the master comes. If we are going to hear well done. Watch him. This is something that, and these two are very important. This is something that some of us are not taking time on doing. Because we are busy doing other things. Busy. We are busy enjoying life. We are busy getting on. We are busy getting things done. We are busy fixing up this and fixing up that. That in a moment we might leave it or it leaves us. I'm saying, friends, it's time for us to watch. Watch what is happening. See what the devil is doing around us. And keep walking with Jesus. God, this is hard for me, but I'm going to walk. I'm going to watch. I'm going to walk and I'm going to watch. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Watch as you walk and work in his vineyard. Watch as you work in the ministry for Christ. Be vigilant. Be wise. Because the moment is at hand. It's time for us to watch, church. Why we must watch? Because it is necessary. Watch speaks to look or observe attentively. Understand that. We need to observe attentively. Not just observe, but pay attention. Look. See what the devil is throwing down on this earth. And understand that the coming of the Lord is near. And it is necessary that you get yourself saved. Finally, Oh boy, waiting for the final one, eh? Final one, eh? This is where some of us, and we keep on talking about the church, never, the Bible never said we must fast, and the Bible never said we must this, and the Bible never said we must that, but it said it right here now. So whatever in your mind I'm saying to you, take it out and get yourself to that fasting. The last one, is that it said? What the last one said? Fasting, that is what I want to point out. If we are going to continue the ministry of God and to hear well done, we better find our moments to fast. And stop talking about the Bible never said this and the Bible never said that. Take away yourself from some of the things that you believe, you and I believe is necessary, and get to what is indeed necessary. And one of those things, it said here, out of those 9 things that we must walk in, is fasting. Yes. Some of us are too lazy. We better shut off and walk in the things that are necessary to take us to that point where we will hear, well done. And so I asked the question earlier on, if when God said well done to us, will it be a satisfactory one to us? Will we be able to say, yes, Lord, I've done my best. I've been to fasting 6 times out of the year. When we have it 50 times out of the year. I'm giving it to you like that. Yes, Lord, I've been to fasting 5 times out of the year. When we have 50 days in the week, in the year to fast. And some of us only come 5 times out of the year. And when we hear, well done, we're going to walk away. Yes, Lord, I've done my best. When you know, in fact, we didn't do our best. And I could go on and on and on and on and say all these things out of the year when we should do and say and go. We find ourselves doing the things that are not necessary to our spiritual life. And that's why Jesus said to Mary and Martha, when Martha was in the kitchen worrying about fixing up, painting up, washing the dishes and fixing up the kitchen, she was cumbered in her heart and she went to Jesus and said, Lord, do you not care that my dear come and help me in the kitchen? Jesus said, Mary had chosen that which was necessary or is necessary. I'm saying to somebody today, watch the path you want. And choose that which is necessary for you to hear. Welcome, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy that I've prepared for you from the foundation of the earth, of the world rather. Beloved, if we are going to hear those words, we must grow in patience. We must grow in true affections. We must grow in necessity. We must grow in distress. We must grow in stripes. We must grow even though we are imprisoned by whatever situation. We must grow in tumults and so as to continue our walk. We must grow in labor. We must grow in watching. And we must grow in fasting. If we are going to be able to hear from the Master's mouth, well done. To be continued. How is our walk today? I won't give you a hint of what we will be continuing on next week. But if you are wise enough and you read those verses down, you would have understood, you would have known what next. So walk in those things, beloved, and you are on your way for a rejoicing moment. Amen. Today, if you are here and you felt as though you are not walking in these things, an invitation is open to you. And I ask of you to come. Walking these things. Stand on your feet for me. Look for that sign for me. Oh, it's there. Have you any room for Jesus? Number 328. 328. Before you sing, keep playing. Give this room to Jesus for those that we must walk in. we become ministers in God's ministry. And as we are ministers in God's ministry. Now I say become for those that need to become a part of his ministry. And I said for those that are a part of his ministry, let's walk in these things. If you feel you are not there, God knows the altar is here. Come and find that room and give it to him. Somebody sing for me. Listen, don't say, this is serious. And I want you to pay attention. We're going to sing. I want you to imagine yourself standing before God, waiting to hear, well done. But to your surprise, it's depart from me. I know you not. What's your life like today?
Not get my reward because it was not
not a part to the desire and the outcome of God's intention, you are going to be disappointed. Look in your life one more time and make it up with God. We can lose everything. We can walk away from everything. Me, I know you're not. It's gonna be the worst day in your life, and it will be a forever one. Today is that time accepted. Tomorrow you may call it being the last verse. Room and time now give to Jesus. I'm saying to somebody, the Spirit bids me to plead. The Spirit is saying to somebody, today is the day of the time that you must give Jesus that space. Why it is necessary? It is necessary. You may be able to move along without it now. But when it comes to that day when you have to cross Jordan, and you will be alone, nobody to cross Jordan with you, it's going to be the saddest day. I request that we sing the third verse. And we are going to do it. I'm very serious here. This is a serious moment. We are standing before God, though we cannot see Him. But a day is coming when the sunrise is face to face, shall I behold Him. Whispering to somebody today. but you are disobedient. And I heard a songwriter say, touch something, musician.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you.
Jesus is calling
for me.
Follow him.
water baptism and to take him as Lord of my life.
It is necessary. Praise the Lord. I'm gonna pray. And I'm gonna ask you to go to Sister Latoya. She's gonna take your phone number, your name, family, and everything. We'll be in touch. Everybody stand as we look to God and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we stand and bow before you right now, God. We thank you for who you are, for your amazing love that you bestowed on us. And Lord, as today we came here and we found a mindset that, Lord, we are just waiting to hear well done from you. But as we find that mindset, God, I am praying that our desire will be your desire.
Amen.
The outcome will be your outcome, God.
Yes,
and so whatever we are doing that is not your desire and not our outcome, I pray that you break it down, Jesus. So that we can walk in these things.
Yes.
Lord God, I pray for every one of us that are going through all these situations. Help us to know that in them we have to walk.
Yes.
So as to hear well done from you.
Yes, Lord.
And so re-energize us, strengthen us. God, I pray for all those that are at the altar. That I hear, God, to just regain strength. I hear for something, God, that they're longing for. I hear, oh God, just to let you know how much, God, they desire you. I lift them up before you, God. Let your mercy be extended to them as they walk, Lord God, this pathway. Help them also to realize that as they walk, they must walk in the necessities of life. That will bring them to that point when you will say, well done.
Amen.
And so, God, I pray for a cravenness to be over them spiritually. And that they will wrap up and tie up themselves in you, God. Until death, God, until you return. I pray, God, you embed yourself around them. And lead them, Lord, on that path. I pray for these two sisters, God.
Yes.
Who came here today. And God found something in you. They chose to walk with you, Lord. And so I lift their spirit before you right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody say, in the name of Jesus. God, separate them. Cover them, Lord. Lead them from into your desire and your outcome. Bless them. Tear down the walls. Tear down the walls that have been keeping them back. And set them free, Lord. Set their spirit free, because their will must be to hear well done from you. Thank you for the song you gave the choir, Lord, and set this peace. And I pray you'll continue to anoint them. Continue to speak to them. Continue to speak to us as we work together for your kingdom.
Yes.
We are your ministers in your ministry. You had heard us. You had accepted us. You had helped us. And therefore, Lord, we want to walk in these things. So when you come, we can rejoice in that which you had prepared for us. Take us over. Bless the congregation, the visitors. Bless every one of us as we go. I ask it all in Jesus' name.
Praise God.
In Jesus' name. Hallelujah.